When I think of sports, I would always think of the Las Vegas Raiders and the Las Vegas Golden Knights. Now, for sports, there is always a famous athlete participating in the sport, right? But what if I told you that some of the athletes are not what they seem behind the eyes? So today in this video, I'm going to be telling you guys athletes who committed horrible crimes. What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another video. And today, we're going to be talking about athletes who committed horrible crimes. So let's get started. Now, sorry if I look a little washed out today, is because I'm using the Elgato key light, and also if I sound so different than my previous videos is because I'm feeling a little bit under the weather right now, so I'm sorry. But yeah, just time just changes, and the weather can be unpredictable sometimes, so what can you do? But yes, in this video, what I'm going to be talking about is some of the athletes who committed horrible crimes. Now, a lot of them are convicted, so be ready for that. Anyways, let's go ahead and get to it. Mike Tyson. It comes as a shock to some of you that Mike Tyson actually committed crimes in his prime year. Now, today, he is a completely free man. Now, before I get into the crimes he committed, let me give you guys some context. Michael Gerard Tyson is an American former professional boxer who competed from 1985 to 2005. Nicknamed Iron Mike and Kid Dynamite in his early career, and later known as the baddest man on the planet, Tyson is regarded as one of the greatest heavyweight boxers of all time. He retired in 2005 after winning 50 fights and 44 by knockout. So, what crimes did he commit in his earlier years? In his earlier years, he committed several crimes in his youth, including robbing stores, pickpocketing, and mugging people. In September 1991, Tyson was indicted of one count of 2 counts of criminal deviant behavior, and 1 count of confinement. He was accused by Desiree Washington, a contestant in the Miss Black America pageant, who claimed that Tyson forced himself on her in his Indianapolis hotel room. Tyson was convicted on the count of R-word as well as on 2 counts of deviant sexual conduct. The judge sentenced Tyson to 10 years in prison, as well as a $30,000 fine. The conviction was upheld in the appeal, and the U.S. Supreme Court refused to hear Tyson's R-word case appeal once again. Tyson was released after serving 3 years and 6 weeks from the Indiana Youth Center in Plainfield, Indiana. And if you think that he did not commit any of those crimes, he did. But it's not just that, he also did this too. In 1997, Tyson's boxing license was revoked for 1 year after he bit a chunk off of opponent Evander Holyfield's ear during a boxing match. In the following years, Tyson was charged with 2 counts of misdemeanor assaults, 1 felony count of possession of drug paraphernalia, 1 felony count of drug possession, and 2 misdemeanor counts of driving under the influence. Now back to the statement on what I just said about biting someone's ear off. Imagine if he bit Logan Paul's ear off, like, that will be brutal. And especially considering the fact that it will be streaming, you know, it'll be on live streaming and stuff, then yeah, it'll be brutal. And that way the audience will be shocked. Man. But after his retirement in 2005, he is now living a normal life, which I don't know if he'll continue doing boxing again, but who knows, because like I said, with the Logan Paul fight, this is gonna be brutal. Tonya Harding. Now, it comes to shock to some of you that Tonya Harding did commit a crime in her past year, and some of you might be highly anticipated for this one, but now you can thank me that I added her on the list. But for those of you who don't know who's Tonya Harding, I'm gonna give you guys some context. Tonya Maxine Price is an American former figure skater, retired boxer, and reality television personality. Born in Portland, Oregon, Harding was raised by her mother, who enrolled her in ice skating lessons at 3 years old. There's a movie about her that Margot Robbie portrayed in called I, Tonya. So, what crimes did she commit in her earlier years? On January 6, 1994, Nancy Kerrigan became the victim of Harding and Gilly Lee's lust to win. Hired hitmen stamped clubs Kerrigan's right knee, and cameras were able to capture the immediate aftermath. after an FBI investigation is launched into Harding's bodyguard, Eckhart, on January 12, 1994. Eckhart confesses to his involvement in the attacks and incriminates Stant, Gillily, and Smith, who was the driver of the getaway car. Just 2 days after the investigation, on January 14, 1994, Kerrigan held a press conference as she tried to remain positive at a press conference after a number of criminals were formally charged. At the same time, the United States Figure Skating Association, or USFSA for short, deliberates on whether Harding should compete in the Olympics and ultimately decides that she is allowed to since. Aside from her repeated denials of being involved in Kerrigan's attack, no evidence has emerged to contradict her claims. Although Harding would continue to deny any involvement, Gillily would confess on January 27 that he orchestrated the assault and would also implicate Harding, Eckhart, Stant, and Smith. On February 1st, in exchange for a lighter sentence, Gillily testifies against his ex-wife and pleads guilty to the crime of racketeering. Days later, Gillily and Harding's trash was recovered, revealing notes of Kerrigan's practice schedule in Massachusetts. A handwriting expert confirms that the notes were written by Harding. A few months after his confession, on March 16, 1994, Harding officially pleaded guilty to the charge of conspiracy to hinder prosecution. She receives 3 years probation and is slapped with a $160,000 fine. A few months later, her 1994 national championship title was revoked, and she was banned from the USFSA forever. With the exception of Harding, everyone else involved in Kerrigan's attack serves jail time. Now, I'm not gonna lie to you, this is one of those cases that one famous person is actually pretty jealous of. Now, no athlete can be jealous of another athlete because of how successful and how, you know, more talented they are. Just because an athlete is more talented than anyone else in the world doesn't mean you should be, you know, oh, I want to target that person because I want to make myself better. I feel like it's just one of those cases where Tonya is just jealous of Nancy. And it's safe to say that Nancy did not forgive Tonya for what she did. Ron Artest. Okay, for those of you who seen the YouTuber, I don't know Sterling, you're welcome. You guys are lucky that he is on the list. If you guys don't know who is Ron Artest, I will give you guys some context on who is he. Legally named Meta Sandefjord Artest, previously named Meta World Peace, is an American former professional basketball player who scored 19 seasons in the National Basketball Association, otherwise the NBA. Under the name of Ron Artest, he played college basketball for the St. John's Red Storm. He's also known for the Malice at the Palace incident that happened on November 19th, 2004. Now that event happened way before I was born. I was born on December 31st, 2004. The event took place on November 19th, 2004. But yeah, if you guys are here for the Malice at the Palace incident, don't worry. I will cover that. But for now, I want to talk to you guys on what other crimes he committed before the incident happened. In 2002, Artest was charged in New York with harassment and criminal contempt and was ordered to undergo 26 hours of anger management consultation after the authorities said that he struck a former girlfriend who was the mother of two of Artest's three children. Artest was arrested on March 5th at his estate in Loomis, 25 miles northeast of Sacramento, and was released from custody after posting a $50,000 bond. A Placer County Sheriff's report said Artest grabbed a woman and pushed her down, then slapped her face during an argument. The report, which did not identify the victim because it was a domestic violence incident, said Artest took a phone from the woman the first time she tried to call 911. When she reached 911, the woman at first complained that Artest was taking the family Homer from the home, according to a recording of the call released by the sheriff's department. The woman then told the dispatcher that her finger was cut and her leg scratched, and that she broke the windshield of the vehicle. 5 days after his arrest, Artest said that he'd stumbled as a father and a husband and apologized to his wife and family, as well as to the Kings and his teammates. He sat out 2 games, but was not suspended and continued to receive his salary. Artest's attorney, William Partanova, said Wednesday that he had not yet seen the charges. Ron's first priority remains his family, and the process will simply have to work itself through, he said. Portanova declined to say whether Artest had any contact with his family since the incident. The family continues to request privacy during these difficult times, he said. Immediately after the arrest, the county sheriff's department obtained an emergency protective order that prevented Artest from returning to his home or contacting the woman until she could obtain a restraining order. Officials with the Placer County Clerk's Office and Sheriff's Department said Wednesday they had no record that she had sought or obtained such an order. Calls Wednesday to Artest's agent, Mark Stevens, were not immediately returned. King spokesman Darren May said he had no immediate comment. Now, keep in mind that this incident not only damaged Artest's basketball career, but his life too. As a member of the Indiana Pacers, he was the central figure in 2004 brawl with Detroit Pistons fans. He received a 73-game suspension and lost almost $5 million in the salary for jumping into the stands and throwing punches. Artest and teammate Steven Jackson were sentenced to 1 year of probation and 60 hours of community service after pleading no contest to misdemeanor assault charges. And yes, I'm talking about the Malice at the Palace incident for those of you who don't know. Now, going back to his first case with him beating his girlfriend, not only that it could damage his entire family, but it can also damage himself. So, yeah, Ron Artest, you fucked up big time. The Big Show. Yes, I will be talking about a WWE wrestler, so yes, WWE wrestlers are athletes too. So, now if you guys don't know who's The Big Show, again, I'm going to give you guys some context. Paul Donald White II is an American professional wrestler and actor. He is currently signed to All Elite Wrestling as a wrestler and was a commentator for its web television show, AEW Dark Elevation, under his real name of Paul White. So, what crimes did he commit? In December 1998, while still working for World Championship Wrestling, Paul White allegedly exposed his genitals to a hotel worker in Memphis, Tennessee. He was arrested on incident exposure charges. However, due to insufficient evidence, Paul White was found not guilty and released. However, after 4 months after the incident, in March 1999, The Big Show would be arrested again for punching a man in a bar. Because of the footage shown in the video, Paul was found not guilty of the assault charges he was arrested for. Paul would go on that year to leave WCW and join the WWF, where he would end up punching people absolutely nowhere near as hard as that. Now, given that this dude has the audacity to punch a man in the public bar and knocking him out unconscious and stuff, then yeah, if I were to go up against him, then yeah, I would be immediately dead. I don't know how I feel about that, but as a non-drinker myself, I mean, I'm only 19, so anyways, on to the next one. But I must warn you, the crimes down there are gonna get a lot worse. Chris Benoit. Now, it may be a shock to some of you that I actually don't know who's Chris Benoit. I am so sorry if that is a shocker to some of you, but I actually have a good friend at work. His name is Vaughn. He told me about it, and I would like to give him a shout out for that. So thank you, Vaughn, for telling me about Chris Benoit, and as well as another athlete that he told me about, so I will get into that as well. But for now, we're going to talk about Chris Benoit. Christopher Michael Benoit was a Canadian professional wrestler. He worked for various pro wrestling promotions during his 22-year career, including most notably the World Wrestling Federation, World Wrestling Entertainment, otherwise known as the WWF or the WWE, World Championship Wrestling, WCW, and Extreme Championship Wrestling, ECW, in the United States of America, New Japan Pro Wrestling, NJPW, in Japan, and Stampede Wrestling in his native Canada. Now, did I say that the crimes down here are gonna get a lot worse? Yes, you heard that right. It's gonna get a lot worse from here on out. So, what crimes did he commit? Over the weekend of June 22nd, 2007, Chris Benoit uncharacteristically missed a WWE event. Though nobody could have ever imagined that no simple no-show would become one of the darkest days in wrestling history. Late at night on Friday, Chris Benoit killed his wife, Nancy, in an upstairs bedroom in their house. Nancy's limbs were bound and her injuries showed that Benoit had pressed his knee into her back while pulling a cord around her neck, strangling her to death. The next morning, Benoit drugged his 7-year-old son, Daniel, with Xanax, leaving him unconscious, and then Benoit brutally suffocated him. Benoit left a copy of the Bible by each body, which Sandra Tuffoloni considered strange, on Talk is Jericho, as they weren't very religious. Now, I'm talking about Chris and his family. They're not very religious at all, like at all. On that Saturday, Benoit talked on the phone to his good friend Chavo Guerrero and told him that Nancy and Daniel were both suffering from food poisoning. On Talk is Jericho, Chavo said something sounded off with Benoit, especially with the way he said goodbye, saying, "Chavo, I love you."
Hi, I just spoke to one of the other officers there. My name is Dennis Fagan. I'm a retired detective in New York City. I run the security for World Wrestling, and one of our wrestlers that lives down there is missing, and he told me to just to say we need a welfare check done.
Okay, what's the address?
130 Green Meadow Lane. The zip code is 30215.
All right, Dennis, what's your last name?
Fagan, F-A-G-A-N.
And what's his name?
Chris Benoit.
On June 24, 2007, Chris Benoit died by suicide, creating a noose from the end of a weigh machine cord to hang himself. Benoit was found by the police hanging from the pulley cable. On Talk Is Jericho, Sandra Telfaloni gave further details of what Benoit was doing over that horrible weekend. Sandra said that Benoit's computer search history shows he has researched the quickest and easiest way to break a neck. On the Dark Side of the Ring, it was also revealed Benoit had Googled a Bible story about the prophet Elijah and, quite morbidly, the resurrecting of a dead boy. When nobody from WWE had heard from Benoit in over 24 hours, Chavo Guerrero showed the messages he got from Benoit to WWE management. WWE then called the Fayetteville police, who discovered the three bodies at the house. Michael Benoit told the Atlanta Journal-Constitution via Cage Side Seats, said that Benoit had left a handwritten suicide note saying, "I'm preparing to leave this earth." Now, this case itself is just really devastating, considering the fact that it's both a double homicide and suicide. So, oh man. Yeah, I don't know. Like, this is just one of those instances where something is going on with a person's mind, and you know, and something just snaps. It can happen at any. It can happen to anyone. So, man. OJ Simpson. Even though he did pass away recently on April 10th, 2024, I'm still going to include him because of the crimes he committed. Orthonel James Simpson, commonly referred to as O.J. Simpson, was an American former football running back, actor, and broadcaster. He played in the National Football League for 11 seasons, primarily with the Buffalo Bills, and is regarded as one of the greatest running backs of all time. He was inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame in 1985. So, what crimes did he commit in his earlier years before he passed? After retiring from football, Simpson became a film and television actor and sports commentator. On June 12, 1994, his ex-wife, Nicole Brown Simpson, and her friend, Ronald Goldman, were stabbed to death outside her home in Los Angeles. Simpson was arrested with the two murders on June 17th. He pleaded not guilty and hired a team of prominent lawyers to handle his defense. His lengthy, nationally televised trial became the focus of unprecedented media scrutiny. A jury acquitted Simpson of the murder charges on October 3, 1995. In a separate civil trial decision in 1997, he was found liable for the deaths of his ex-wife and Goldman and was ordered to pay $3.35 million in damages of the families. Simpson later collaborated with Pablo F. Fengives on If I Did It, which he hypothesized about how he would have committed the murders. Public outrage prevented its initial publication in 2006, but bankruptcy courts subsequently awarded the book's rights to the Goldman family, who released the work in 2007. Later that year, Simpson was arrested after he and several other men entered a Las Vegas hotel room and took memorabilia items that Simpson claimed had been stolen from him. The incident resulted in Simpson being charged with a murder of crimes, including armed robbery and kidnapping. On October 3rd, 2008, a jury found him guilty of all charges. He was later sentenced to a minimum of 9 years in prison. With a possible maximum sentence of 33 years, Simpson was granted parole in 2017. O.J. Simpson died on Wednesday, April 10th, 2024, at his home in Las Vegas. He was only 76 years old. Henry Ruggs III. Okay. Now, for those of you who don't know who's Henry Ruggs III, I will give you guys some context on who he is and what crimes he committed. Henry James Ruggs III is an American former professional football player who was a wide receiver for two seasons with the Las Vegas Raiders in the National Football League, otherwise known as the NFL. Now, like I said, on what crimes he committed, I will get into that just about now. Clark County District Judge Jennifer Schwartz sentenced Ruggs to a minimum of 36 months and a maximum of 120 months after Ruggs pleaded guilty to one count of driving while impaired, resulting in death, and one count of vehicular manslaughter. Ruggs is eligible for parole after 3 years. over the past 21 months, I've searched within to find the answers to explain my selfish behavior on that day. I have no excuse and pray that accepting responsibility and my guilty plea can allow me to begin a healing process and allow everyone involved to be healed also. Rugs told the judge. My actions are not a true reflection of me. I'm committed to creating greater awareness and educating others about the dangers that driving at excessive speed and driving impaired can come with. Ruggs was traveling more than 150 miles per hour, his alcohol level more than twice the legal limit, before his car rear-ended another car, killing the driver, Tina Tintor. Prosecutors have said, he does accept his anticipated incarceration completely, Your Honor. I secretly predict that when Henry leaves prison, he will do anything in his power to teach young people not to ever drink, speed, and drive, Ruggs' attorney added. Now to be fair, drinking and driving should never be legal. I'm not gonna lie to you, it can cause like some serious casualties around you and around others. And yeah, it can leave you into fucked up situations like this, so yeah, on to the next one. Karl Malone. This case is one reason as to why we have successful sting operations nowadays. Before we had sting operations, we had Chris Hansen. Now, after the incident with Chris Hansen, he is no longer catching predators. I could be wrong, but nowadays I don't see him catching any more predators. Now, we have some very popular YouTubers who are eligible for catching predators. Skeeter John is one of the most popular ones out there. Protect the Innocent is also another popular one out there. Even though they're not as popular as they used to be, which all of their videos are going downhill now, Luxury Pranks also does sting operations too. I don't know if they're real or fake, but they still do some sting operations. Now, before I get into the crimes that he committed, let me give you guys some context on who is Karl Malone. Karl Anthony Malone is an American former professional basketball player in the National Basketball Association, otherwise known as the NBA. Nicknamed the Mailman, he is considered one of the greatest power forwards in NBA history. He played for the Utah Jazz in 1985 and became the Hall of Fame induction in 2010. Now, the crime that he committed is too gruesome, so get ready for that. If you're a victim of SA, I'm sorry, but you're welcome to leave the video. R-word allegations against NBA and Utah Jazz legend Karl Malone have resurfaced after basketball authorities got some heat on social media for having him judge the slam dunk contest at the NBA All-Star Weekend in Salt Lake City. The NBA has been accused of overlooking past allegations against Malone when including him in the All-Star Weekend, with many taking social media to voice their concern that his demeanors have not been taken into consideration. One furious basketball fan tweeted their disgust in a post that has been read hundreds of thousands of times and liked more than 14,000 times. She tweeted, "Call a spade a spade. Karl Malone R-worded a 12-year-old and she got pregnant. It comes up maybe once a year because of basketball shit and it dies down. Men just keep living their life, being abusers and flourishing, and people talking about it like a fun fact and not a literal crime." Bell has said that her family declined to press statutory charges at the time, as it was clear Malone, who was at Louisiana Tech University, was heading for a big NBA career. Malone later denied paternity of the child, Demetrius Bell, who went on to play as a lineman in the NFL. Bell's family sued Malone and eventually settled out of court with the condition that the basketball star was acknowledged as the father of Demetrius Bell. Malone finally met his son when he turned 17. Bell reportedly told him that it was too late for him to be his father, and he had to make it on his own. In 2014, he reunited with Demetrius, and in 2018, Malone said that he talks to his son nearly every day. During the proceedings, Malone was held in contempt of court and agreed to another out-of-court settlement. Daryl and Cheryl followed Malone in playing basketball at Louisiana Tech, with Cheryl enjoying a 10-year WNBA career. Starring for the Detroit Shock, she won 3 champions during her time there. It wasn't until 1998 that Malone acknowledged his twins, later admitting, "I didn't handle it right. I was wrong. Father time is the biggest thief out there and you can't get it back." Now, this case is definitely as to why we have sting operations nowadays. This case is definitely one of the sickest cases I've ever heard. Impregnating a 13-year-old, yeah, that's fucked up. That's really fucked up enough, but man, and for him to tell the twins that he did not, that he impregnated a 13-year-old, wow. Anyways, on to the next one. Aaron Hernandez. I feel like this video wouldn't be complete without talking about Aaron Hernandez. His case is a very accurate example as to why fame can ruin everything. Now, before I get into the crimes that he committed, I want to talk to you guys, who is Aaron Hernandez? Aaron Josef Hernandez was an American professional football player who was a tight end. He played in the National Football League for 3 seasons with the New England Patriots. Hernandez played college football for the Florida Gators, earning his first name All-American honors and winning the 2008 BCS National Championship game. Due to concerns towards his size and off-the-field incidents, he was not selected until the 4th round of the 2010 NFL draft by the Patriots. Alongside teammate Rob Gronkowski, Hernandez formed one of the league's most dominant tight end duos, becoming the first pair to score at least 5 touchdowns in each consecutive seasons for the same team. He also made an appearance in Super Bowl 46. Now, going back to his teammate Rob Gronkowski, let me show you a small clip of the interview of him refusing to talk about Aaron at all.
I do have to ask you, when you heard about Aaron Hernandez, what you thought, what your reaction was?
Next question. I learned that from Drew Rosenhaus. Next question. But
it had to be a shock for you, though. It had to be a shock for all your teammates.
Next question.
All right, then I'll ask you. It seems to me that these two men played on opposite sides of the line, but they had more than that in terms of being opposites.
And truthfully, I'm not going to go. Yeah, I'm not going to go there.
Right now. Don't walk off.
Right now.
I'll change the subject.
It was clear that in an interview that he did not feel comfortable talking about Aaron at all, neither did the other team members of the New England Patriots. So what crimes did Aaron commit? On June 26, 2013, the nation awoke to the sight of a star player on one of the NFL's models franchises being escorted out of his house by police, a t-shirt pulled over his cuffed wrists. New England Patriots tight end Aaron Hernandez was charged later that day with the murder of Odin Lloyd, whose body had been found 6 days earlier near Hernandez's home. According to prosecutors, Hernandez, Ernest, Wallace, and Carlos Ortiz picked up Lloyd on June 17, 2013 from his Dorchester and drove into Industrial Park in North Attleboro, near Hernandez's home. Hernandez then shot Lloyd several times, two of which were direct hits to his chest. Now, if you think that he committed a crime of murdering Olin Lloyd, no, he didn't. There was one other crime that he committed, but way before that. On July 16th, 2012, two men, Daniel De Alburo and Safriel Furtado, were shot to death in their car as they waited a red light in Boston's South End neighborhood. Although, the motive for Hernandez killing Lloyd was never clearly stated by prosecutors, they managed to paint a picture of a young man who, according to a witness who testified at the murder trial, was secretive and easily provoked at mere slights, in spite of his good looks, sizable fortune, and bright future as an NFL star. Witnesses testified that 2 nights prior to Lloyd's murder, he and Hernandez had gone together to a Boston club together, where Hernandez allegedly got angry when Lloyd began talking with other people. Hernandez allegedly stormed out to his vehicle and returned with a handgun, which allegedly was used to kill Lloyd 2 days later. Although the murder weapon wasn't found and no potential eyewitnesses to the murder testified, the prosecution built their case using circumstantial evidence, including cell phone records, DNA, surveillance footage, and various other evidence discovered at the crime scene. The prosecution was able to construct a scenario of Lloyd's final ride, which included testimony by witnesses to Hernandez's suspicious behavior before and after the murder. On May 28, 2014, Hernandez pleaded not guilty to charges in connection with the death of De Alburo and Furtado. A prosecutor says Hernandez was angry because De Alburo accidentally bumped into him at a nightclub while dancing, spilling his drink. Now, given that this dude has committed several crimes before, I found an article with the timeline stating everything that had happened, and the timeline can be found in the description below. But to summarize, on April 15th, 2015, Hernandez was convicted of first-degree murder, carries a mandatory life sentence of life imprisonment. Then, on February 14th, 2017, Hernandez goes on trial for murder in the 2012 killings of Daniel Del Burro and Safriel Furtado. On April 6th, 2017, prosecutors and Hernandez's lawyers presented their closing arguments. On April 7th, 2017, the jury began deliberating. Finally, on April 14th, 2017, Hernandez was acquitted of murder in the 2012 killings of Daniel Del Burro and Safriel Furtado. However, the trial may have ended, but it had not gone far. Aaron would then commit suicide at his prison cell on April 19, 2017, at 3:05 a.m. at 27 years old. However, he suffered a brain condition known as chronic traumatic encephalopathy, or CTE for short. Now, I am no doctor when it comes to this, but based on the images, I can tell that Aaron Hernandez's brain is not really that normal. Now, I'll give you guys a brief context as to what CTE does to your brain. What that does is a buildup of protein called tau around the blood vessels. Tau buildup in CTE is different from accumulations of tau found in Alzheimer's disease and other forms of dementia. CTE is thought to cause areas of the brain to waste away, known as atrophy. CTE can also affect the behavior of a person, such as the decline of memory and cognition, as well as depression, suicidal behavior, poor impulse control, aggressiveness, and eventually dementia similar to Alzheimer's disease. Like I said, I am not a doctor, but for those of you who are, let me know in the comments below and tell me if anyone has CTE. Has anyone has suffered from CTE at all, other than Aaron Hernandez, because no person can suffer from CTE. Now, for those of you who are a doctor or a nurse, correct me if I'm wrong in the comments below and tell me if the CTE is caused by minor concussions, because since football is one of the most dangerous sports out there, it can cause several concussions. Now, as to my claim as to why I said fame can ruin everything, a lot of things can happen to your brain, like drugs, everything, and, you know, injuries as well while playing a sport. Yeah, it can cause several injuries. And yeah, Aaron is just one of those people who committed crimes because of the injuries in his brain. So yeah, this is one of those depressing cases out there. Well, that's all I have for you today. Thank you for watching this video. Please subscribe if you have not already. Leave a like on the video and comment down below. Also, share the video to the person who you know, because if you see them in their depression state and, you know, having them to take their own life, then yeah, that's not good. There is help available. Tell them that you are not alone and they will always be there for you. So, and yeah, follow my Instagram and join my Discord server. The link for both of those will be in the description below. Anyways, have a good day, y'all.